Good morning. This is Dr. Vineet Chauhan, Assistant Professor, School of Management, Sir Padmapur Singhania University. Today, we will discuss about the topic of financial reporting. This topic is under the subject BM553 for MA first sem. The flow of our presentation will include the following. First of all, we will discuss the financial reporting and its user. Thereafter, we will move towards the history of the accounting, double entry system. Then we check out the process of accounting, generally accepted accounting principle, the accounting concepts, accounting conventions, basic accounting terminologies, types of revenue and expenditure, users and uses of accounting information, the current generally accepted accounting principle, and IFRS and Indian accounting standard. And finally, we will conclude our lecture with convergence issue. Let us start the topic with financial reporting. Financial reporting is what? Financial reporting is the method of reporting the financial background of the company to the financial entities and to the stakeholders. This reporting has a particular pattern which need to be followed under the account. For this purpose, the method of reporting of financial accounting work will be the final accounts under annual report. For this purpose, the information is gathered with the financial accounting, which will be used during the period of 1 year, that is the financial year, which starts from 1st April to 31st March next year. The current financial year for which the company will report its accounting procedure, that will be 1st April 2015 to 31st March 2016. The another thing which we will discuss is under the financial reporting is use of providing accounting information. Each and every single entity who counted under the stakeholders part will require to know that what company has did in the previous year, what was the financial result of the company. So that is why the financial reporting is the method, is the model which is used for the purpose of providing information. Investors, they require the information about the company's profit. If a company is profitable, if the company is having good future prospect, the investor will invest in that particular company. So they will require the financial information first, and for the purpose of making accounting, making annual report, the first thing is that company should do the work of accounting from the beginning till the end of the accounting year. Now we start the financial accounting part, and to give it to you a brief history of the financial accounting part, we start with the ancient time. In the ancient time, I have shown it to you with the help of an example that why accounting was required. As per the example, it is clear that in past, in the ancient time, when we were having limited persons and limited transaction, it was very easy for a person to remember the transaction. For example, Ram, who is a trader, has manufactured 4 products which he wants to sell it to the 4 customers. Since the number of customers are only 4, he could be able to recall that this is the sale and this is the amount due to that particular person. Thereafter, what has happened? That the number of transactions and the number of people have grown up, have grown more. The same trader who has made 4 products is now having a consumer base of n number of customers. And that is why he was unable to recall that what is the transaction, what is the amount due, what will be his financial strength, what is his profit or not. So for that purpose, he need to record the records of the customers further and with the help of a proper and appropriate method, so that he can record it properly and at the time of taking the data, at the time of taking the information, that will be available to him. So his problem was that how he will record all the transactions of all the customers together, and that is why he was requiring a particular method of accounting. So for that purpose, an idea of improving in the accounting system, idea of developing an accounting system was required. In the ancient time, the system which was in India, that is the kingdom system, under which the king has appointed some of the persons who are aware with the accounting, and they were doing the work of accounting, but the proper system which is required was not there. So in the old time, the first person who has given his time and who has given him the way of maintaining the records properly was the Chanakya. He has written his book, under which he requires and he has given information to the king that the king require a particular person who will be responsible for the accounting. He has also mentioned the qualification which is required to the persons doing the work of accounting. Similarly, when the time passes, the modern accounting has emerged in year 1494 with Lucas Pacioli, an expert of accounting or so-called father of accounting, has given his new idea. He has written a book named The Composite Scriptures. This book was the base of English accounting system. As per this book, the well-developed system of accounting was developed by him. Similarly, that system is being used till today. Now we will discuss the accounting and its definition. The widely known accounting definition is accepted all over the world, which is given by American Institute of Certified Public Accountants. It says that accounting is the art of recording, classifying and summarizing in a significant manner and in terms of monetary transactions and events which are in part or at least of financial character and interpreting the result thereof. If we discuss this definition, we will find it out that what are the basic characteristics of the accounting. If we check it out, the first line of the definition, it says that accounting is the art. So what is taken from the art in the accounting, that is the best method for doing the work. In the accounting, there are various performers, there are various forms which has been prepared, so that is why it required help of art. Certainly this art is not the art as per the subject of art, but it is the art of recording. So we will use the only methods and performer which require to record the transaction. After recording the transaction, we classify the transaction, and the classification is based upon the customers, assets, liabilities and all the business terminologies. Later on, with the classification, we will find it out any accounting information which is required. Similarly, this accounting information is prepared and gathered under the summarizing mode. So we will summarize all the transaction with the company, transaction of the company with the external parties. So we will start the accounting from the beginning. We will move ahead till the final account is being prepared, and then thereafter the final account is being given to the investors. What we record under the accounting, that is the monetary transactions and events, suppose if there is a transaction which is not having the accounting background or which is not having a financial or monetary character, that will not be recorded in the accounting. Finally, what is the main crux of this definition? That is interpreting the result. By doing all the accounting work, we will calculate and prepare the final accounts, and as per the final account, we have to interpret the result, which has to be sent to the external parties and to internal parties as the stakeholders of the business. The process of accounting, or the accounting process. Accounting process includes the activities by which the cash is received and paid by the company to the external parties. It also includes the accounting concepts and conventions which should be followed during the accounting process. The process has certain steps, like it starts with the basic transaction. With the transaction, we will go ahead for the purpose of recording the transaction into journal, then the classification. After the classification, the accounts will be closed. After the accounts are being closed, the trial balance is prepared, and with the trial balance, the balance sheet and profit and loss account is being prepared. So this is the process of accounting, and later on, as per the subject requirement, it is reported to the business entities and to the stakeholders. The major activities which is being done in the business is, number one, identification of activities, number two, recording of activities, and number three is the communication of activities. First, we need to identify that which are the activities, and for that purpose we need to follow the concepts and convention. For that purpose we need to identify whether these activities are economic events or not. If these are economic events, then only it will be recorded. It will be recorded with the help of computer now, because in the modern era we are using various softwares like Tally and ERP for classification and summarizing the accounting work. Later on, after the accounts are being prepared, these accounts will be converted into the accounting reports, and the report is given to the external entities and investors for the purpose of their analysis. Now, we need also to know that whether the accounting transactions which is being recorded, is there a rule which is made for recording the transaction? Is there a rule which need to be followed by each and every person who is doing the work of accounting? So, the work of accounting principles is compared and is divided into two parts. The first is that we will check whether these principles are appropriate or not, which principle will be used, and when it will be used. For that purpose, first there is a comparison which is being shown here that shows that the rules of accounting or the generally accepted accounting principles are which type of rule. For example, I have made the example here, the rule of science, which is fixed, which can be proved at any time, at any place, like the rule of gravitational force. If we throw anything in the air, it will come back again, and that is the rule of science, which can be proved any time, at any place. But the rule of accounting is not that strict. The rules of accounting is the creation of individual person, and that is why it can be proved only when other conditions remain same, or it can be proved only in the certain fixed condition. So that is why it is not strict as per the rules of science, but it is at the same time not even flexible that an individual can make correction in the rules. Now we will go ahead and check it out, the various accounting concepts and convention which is being followed in or while doing the work of accounting. Because each and every part of the accounting requires a certain rule to be followed. These are the rules which is included in the accounting concept. If we check it out, the first rule is money measurement concept. The money measurement concept says that a transaction will be recorded only if there are two things which is involved. Number one, money, and number two is the transaction. If out of any one is missing, then that will not be called as a transaction and that will not be recorded. For example, if all the managing director of a company died in an accident, in that case, since there is no monetary value, but this is a major event and it will put an impact on the value of the shares, value of the equity shares which is listed in the share market, but because in the accounting there is no background or there is no monetary transaction, that is why it will not be recorded. Certainly, if anything which is being paid, which is being given to the representative of these people, that amount will be written as a compensation because the money is involved, because it is paid to the external parties. So finally, the money measurement concept says that whatever is recorded in terms of monetary part, that will only be included, otherwise it will not be included. The second important concept is separate entity concept. For each and every business, the separate entity concept will work. In business, if the money is invested by the business, money is invested in the business, it is treated that business has taken loan from the businessman, and that is the example of separate entity concept, which says that business and businessman are the separate entities. The transactions which we are going to record, that will be recorded in the books of business only, not in the books of businessman. So the business and the businessman both are the separate party. When the amount is invested in the business, it is said to be the capital investment, and business will treat it as its liability that will be paid to the businessman again. So that is why the capital and whatever businessman is taken from the business is called to be the drawing, which is reduced from the capital. So in the business, separate entity concept work as the legal guidelines for the purpose of recording the transaction. The third and important concept is going concern concept. Going concern concept is related with the life span of the business, and it is assumed as per this concept that the life span of the business is indefinite. The business will work for a fairly long time period. So if the business will goes on for a fairly long time period, that is why each and every company will buy the fixed assets. For example, if a person knows that his company will be closed in 3 or 4 years, certainly that business will not buy the fixed assets, because the life of the fixed assets is much more. And this concept is the base of the expenditure in capital and revenue part. The capital part means the expenditure which is in terms of assets, while the revenue expenditure means the expenditure which is in terms of only investment in the current expenditure. So the answer of this question, that why the amount is invested in the factory, building, in machine, in furniture, in any other assets, that is that going concern concept, which says that the business will goes on for a longer period. The next important concept is accounting period concept. Accounting period concept is similar to the going concern concept, rather it is the enhancement of that concept. Since going concern concept says that the business will goes on for a fairly long period, and if the business will goes on for a fairly long period, we cannot judge the profit of the company till the capital difference at the beginning and the capital difference, the capital or the amount which you will get it at the closure of the company. For the purpose of calculating the real profit, the life span of a business is converted into 1 year time period, and that time period is called accounting period. So in this, or as per this concept, the life span of a business is divided into the accounting period, and each accounting period will start from 1st April and close on 31st March next year. The next concept is the cost concept. The cost concept is the concept which provides guidelines that how we record the transaction, at which value we record the transaction. So, for this purpose, the assets and liabilities which are recorded in the books will be recorded. There are various types of cost which is available, like market price, sales price, government valuation, purchase price or cost price of a particular assets. When we record the transaction into the books of a particular company, we will always use this concept to record the transaction. And since the name of the concept says that it is cost concept, so what we will do out of these different cost of the assets, like market price, which is the price in existence today, sale price is the price in which the assets can be sold in the market, government valuation is the valuation which is given by the government, and on that particular place or for that particular assets, the value of government is also considered. Last one is the purchase price or the cost price. So out of these different prices, the price of an assets which will be taken, that will be the only price in which company has purchased the assets. Suppose in future the price of a particular assets will increase or will decrease, in that case too, the cost price will be the only price at which it will be recorded. For an assets which is depreciated, the value of assets will be depreciated on the basis of the certain depreciation rates which is mentioned in the Income Tax Act. For example, with a computer which is purchased in 1 lakh rupees and which may be sold after 1 year in 40,000 rupees. If we want to record the price of the computer will be recorded at a price of 1 lakh rupees, because this is the price in which the company has purchased the assets. Irrespective of what is the market price or what will be the sale price of the same in the market, we record the transaction only in the price at which the company has purchased the assets. The next concept is dual aspect concept. Similar to a weighing machine which has both the sides equal, similar to that machine, this concept says that there will be a dual impact of one transaction, means there will be two impact of one transaction. One party will give a product to somebody else and that party will pay the money, so there will be dual impact. There will be one impact of giver and another impact of receiver. So each and every impact of the transaction will be important, and that is why it will be recorded as per the impact. One party is giver, another party is receiver, and as per the weighing machine, the transaction will be recorded in both the sides of the accounts, in the debit side as well as credit side. As per this dual aspect concept, the basic accounting equation is being made. It says that capital of a business and its external liabilities are equal to its total assets. So the total assets of the company which is purchased by the company is the result of either the amount of capital invested by the owner, or which is the result of the amount which is due to the external parties. So there will be a dual impact, and it is also said that in the both impact of the transaction will always be equal. So which means that debit is always equal to credit, and the both part of the weighting machine is should be equal. Thereafter, from the accounting concept, we will be going ahead to the accounting conventions. If we check out the accounting conventions, these are the rules which is based upon a certain area, a certain place, the traditions which is going on at the particular place. So if we check out the accounting conventions, there are total four conventions which is followed in our country. The first is the consistency. Consistency means the method or the system without a frequent change. For example, in the accounting, consistency means the method and the system of accounting that should be consistent. There will be no frequent changes in the accounting. For example, one company which sells the goods with the guarantee, after selling the product at a particular guarantee, it cannot take the guarantee back after the sales. Another example is the rate of depreciation. In the business, if at a particular assets like furniture, we select the rate of depreciation at the rate of 10%, then this rate will be used in the next years and it will not change frequently. If the rate is being changed as per the Income Tax Act and it is allowed to change the rate, then also it will be changed, but there will be no frequent changes which will be allowed. So if it is changed, then it will be fixed for a certain years. Normally it is said to be minimum period of 5 years. So in the accounting, we must be consistent. We cannot make the frequent changes, and that is the first convention. The second convention is materiality convention. Materiality convention says that we have to add important detail which is required for a particular thing, for a particular transaction, for a particular trading between the company and between the other party. And the convention also said that we should ignore the additional detail. This convention is important for each and every company which will identify a particular amount, and that amount is treated to be the immaterial amount. And if we buy anything less than that particular price, we cannot keep it or we cannot record it as the assets, as the transaction which will have the longer period requirement, but we will remove the transactions by recording it as an expenditure. For example, purchase of tools, pen, lock, etc. If we buy these things, we know that these are the things, these are the product which may be in our business for a longer period of time, but we cannot record it as an assets because it is having a very small amount involved. Suppose I have purchased a lock for my company and that lock is costing 200 rupees, which will be with me and which will be useful for 50 years, and in that case I cannot record the price of the lock as an assets because the only one lock is being purchased, because the amount of that lock, the cost price of that lock is immaterial to my business. If it is immaterial, for removing the insufficient detail, what will be done? That the total amount of this bill is recorded as miscellaneous expenditure and it will be removed in the current year. The same will not be identified as an assets. So by doing this, we will remove the immaterial and insufficient detail to be written in the account. The next convention is the disclosure convention. The disclosure convention says that there must be transparency in the accounting work. Accounting work should be transparent, and whatever is the true and fair result, that should be shown to the user. While we are showing the true and fair result to the users, we need to identify that important information is supplied to the users. In case of identifying important information, there are two views of these information: company's view and user's perception. What user require is immaterial for a company. The company will present its view. The company's view will also take care of the mandatory requirement which is implied on the company. So the company will only inform about those information which is mandatory, which is important to the investor, which is important to the other stakeholders. And this is the base of recording and disclosing the information to the external party under the financial reporting. For example, the user may ask to know that what is the amount of a particular transaction, what is the transaction between company and a particular party. But since it is a secret information, a company will never provide to any external party details regarding the company's transaction with a particular party. So that is why, as per the disclosure convention, the company will provide only company's view and the mandatory requirements which will be fulfilled as per this convention. The next convention is conservatism convention. Conservatism convention means the traditional approach. This approach says that a company should always go for anticipating the future loss, but must not anticipate the future profit. If the company will anticipate the future profit, in that case, the anticipated profit will be much more, while it may be possible that the real profit is zero or the real profit is in negative value. That is why, as per this convention, the company will not make any provision on creditors for the purpose of discount. Sometimes it may be that the discount is certain, that it is expected that a person, the other party, will provide a discount to those parties who demand the discount from the company. Then also we cannot write the discount till we receive the discount, till we got the confirmation from the company that the another party is giving it to us a particular discount. As a profit we cannot record this discount, but we will make provision for doubtful debts which is on the debtors. We always expect that some of our debtors will not pay the amount to us, and if it is expected, if the business position of the other external parties will goes down, in that case, to make our business healthier, we will make a provision for bad debts on our debtors, so that in case there will be a real loss, any debtor will turns to be insolvent. In that case, we can save our business, we can protect our business by anticipating that loss earlier. So this conservatism convention says that we must anticipate the future loss, but we will not anticipate any future profit. The next part will be basic accounting terminology. Basic accounting terminology is the terminology which has been used during the business. This terminology starts with the work of accounting, that is bookkeeping and accounting. Bookkeeping includes the work which is recording the transaction into business, classifying the transaction, while the accounting includes the work which is after the bookkeeping. And the main work of accounting is to present the results of the accounting work, while the main work of bookkeeping is to maintain the books to record the transaction into the books. The another thing is that bookkeeping includes the primary recording, recording in the journal, recording in the ledger, while the accounting starts after the bookkeeping is over, and it will take the data from the bookkeeping, analyze the data, classify the data, prepare the final accounts and present it to the stakeholders. So the basic work of accounting which is done under the bookkeeping is journal and ledger, while under the accounting, prior balance and final accounts are being prepared and later on reported to the shareholders. The basic accounting terminology thereafter starts basically from the capital. Capital means the amount which is invested by the owner into the business. As per the various format of the business, this amount will differ. For example, if there is one owner of the company, then the amount is invested by the one person and that is treated to be a sole trader. For a sole trader, whatever is the amount which is invested by him into his business is called the capital. For a partnership firm where we have more than one owner, all of them are partner for a particular share, the amount which is invested by all of them jointly together is called the capital. For a particular company which is made with a fixed amount of share capital called authorized capital, which is the part of its share capital, the first or major part, this authorized capital is the maximum limit up to which a company can issue the shares. After the authorized capital, the issued capital is there. Issued capital means the amount which is issued, the amount of capital which is issued by a company to the prospect investors. Out of the issued capital, a certain amount is being, certain number of shares are being applied by the investors, and if that is different from the issued capital, then the capital is called subscribed capital. The subscribed capital is always less than the issued capital. If the less number of shares are applied, then it should be taken care by the company that at least 90% of the share capital is being applied by the investor. Otherwise, the company will not get the certificate of starting and running the company. So minimum 90% of the share capital which is being issued by a company should be subscribed, then only the company can start. Out of the subscribed capital, sometime it happens that company asks its investor to buy the share capital into various parts. The investor will buy by paying an initial amount of more than 10% of the share price, and the rest amount will be paid in different installments. In that case, the amount which company has received from its shareholders is called paid-up capital. The other part is Indian and foreign capital. Suppose a company will call to the investor to buy the shares from only one particular country, like for India, it will be called, or the capital which is gathered by the company will be called as Indian capital. While in case if the company has asked to the investor of whole world to buy the company share, then the amount of capital which is purchased by the person outside the Indian territory is called foreign capital. The next terminology is assets. It includes those things which have been purchased for the long term period by the company. This purchase of assets is based upon the going concern concept, which says that the business will go on for a fairly long period. The assets is further classified into tangible and intangible assets. Tangible assets are those which we can see, which we can feel, and which we can identify that it is here. For example, machine, factory building, and the building of company's office is called as assets, which is tangible assets. While intangible assets are those assets which cannot be seen, touched, or felt. For example, patent right, trademark, copyright, goodwill, and publication right. Patent is the patent which company has received, and as per the patent condition, no other company will be able to manufacture the same product till the other company pays a particular amount in royalty. Trademark is the mark which is being printed by the company on each of its product which company is manufacturing. If the trademark is popular among the customers, certainly the profit of company will be more. So all the intangible assets are used by the company for the purpose of increasing its sales and improving its profit. The second classification of assets is current and fixed assets. All the current assets are those assets which is kept by the business for a shorter period, and that period is less than 1 year, while the assets which company has purchased for a longer period of time is called fixed assets. So the current assets includes cash, debtors, bank balance, bills receivable, which will be changed within the 1 year time period, while the other assets like building, plant, furniture, machinery is purchased by the company for a longer period of time. So that is why the fixed assets is kept by the company for a longer period of time. Indian and foreign assets. If a company purchases assets in India, that will be called Indian assets, while the assets which is purchased by an Indian company in any other country is called to be a foreign assets. Liability is the next concept. Liability means any amount of the company which is due to the external party, due to the outsiders, that is due to the company's credit purchase of stock, the company's due balance of salaries, etc., company's due balance for any other reason to the outsider is included in the liability. The liability is of two types, long term and short term. If a company will take loan from any external party for a period of more than 1 year, it will be called as long term liability. While if the company require to meet its present requirement and take overdraft from the bank, then it will be called as short term liabilities, which will be paid in near future. So long term liabilities are normally for the purpose of long term investment, like bank loan, long term loan, public debenture, long term finance loan from financial institution, etc., which will be used by the company for a longer period, while the short term liabilities are those which is not paid by the company and which will be the demand of external parties within a small period of time. The next basic terminology includes debtor, which is the part of current assets. Those persons or institution to whom we have sold the goods, our goods on credit, they all are called as debtors. In the debtors, two words D and R is marked separately and highlighted, because debtors are always having debit balance in our books, and they are having debit balance because they are the receiver of particular things from our business. Those people who are counted as debtors, we can demand our money from them at any time. That is why this is called current assets and short period assets. While reverse to that, we also have creditors who are the current counted as current liabilities, and it includes those person or those companies or those parties from whom we have taken the goods, we have purchased the goods or any other thing on credit, and they can demand the amount due to them at any period of time. The next basic accounting terminology include revenue. Revenue is the inflow of cash in the business events. For understanding of business events, I have made a business cycle. This cycle starts with the cash. With the cash, we purchase the raw material. With converting the raw material into the finished goods, we will sell the material, and finally we will be receiving cash again. This cycle is called a revenue cycle for the business. At the end of revenue cycle, we receive the cash from the external party, and the revenue is the total amount which we will receive from the external party. Revenue is also divided into two parts, income revenue and capital revenue. If any revenue which we have received, that is result of business events, that is the result of purchase and sale of goods, then it will be called income revenue. While in case we sold our assets, in case we sell our shares, or in case we go for a loan which is a long term loan, in that case the revenue or the amount which we have received is called to be capital revenue. As for the revenue, the expenses are also there. The expenses are the amount which we spend to the or for the purpose of business events. This is also classified into three parts: revenue expenditure, capital expenditure, and deferred revenue expenditure. First, we check it out, the revenue expenditure. Revenue expenditure is the expenditure which we have paid for the purpose of normal business activities. The normal business activities includes the activity of purchase and sale of goods, the making process of the particular goods, and thereafter the efforts or the cost of the efforts which has been put in for the purpose of sale of the business product. This has a certain example which I have included here: rent, wages, printing and stationery, normal repair, material purchase. This is called as revenue expenditure. The second one was the capital expenditure, the expenditure which is paid for a longer period of time, normally more than 1 year, is called the capital expenditure. It is always of fixed nature and it is paid at the time of purchase of an assets. If we buy the building, if we buy machinery, if we import the machine from the foreign country and establish it at a particular place, then the total cost of importing the machinery, the duties, the taxes of the government, including the legal charges and establishment expenses, together called as capital expenditure, and together it will be written as capital expenditure. The next one is deferred revenue expenditure. Sometimes the company pay for certain expenditure which will be treated as normally, which will be treated normally as the revenue expenditure, but because of the more amount which has been spent on that, and the company believe that the company will get its benefit for a longer period of time, that is why it is written as deferred revenue expenditure. Means the revenue expenditure, but benefit will be taken by the company for more than 1 year, and that is why its expected life period will be the time in which it will be removed from the company's balance sheet. It is written as deferred revenue expenditure. Like, for example, I have mentioned here heavy advertisement expenditure by the company in the first year and the preliminary expenditure, and later on it will be converted as the deferred revenue expenditure. Suppose the benefit is taken for 5 years, so 1/5 part will be reduced each year from this deferred revenue expenditure. So let's stop my presentation, and it includes the basic accounting terminologies and the types of expenditure. Thank you.